everybody. My name is Ryan Hunt, and I'm just going to tell you a lot of my experiences in the psychic world and occult practices, what I used to do, and what the Word of God says. And I'm just going to mention that I'm going to use everything from the Bible here for my ultimate source of truth and final authority, and it should be yours as well. I'm also going to be using the Masonic Occult Symbols Illustrated. And from Dr. Kathy Burns, it's a lot of information and a lot of occult practices. And also to tell you why I was doing psychic work and what the Word of God says about it and all those things. And so, and the first part of the Bible I want to go to is 1 John 4. It says, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world." And then if we go to 2 Thessalonians, in chapter 2, in verse 9, "Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders." So Satan himself is going to deceive a lot of people. He could do a lot of things. So that's why it's always good to test all spirits, because throughout the years, many psychics always believed that they had the gift from God. The problem is, which God are they talking about? So, and that's why I believe we need to examine everything from God's ways of the prophets who had visions or prophecy of foretelling the future, compared to psychics who compared telling the future. And what was the main difference? And why is it good? Is it not good for psychics to do this? What about the prophets? So we'll be examining everything. And I just also want to mention the Hebrew word for prophet is nabi, which means one who is called. So that's very interesting there. So most of the prediction of futures could arrange from picking from the sex of the unborn child to the predicting of an outcome for a battle, or typically the ability to predict the future that gave them. Credibly, when they had an audience listening, they could tell listeners what was on God's mind. Prophets had to work hard to get to change their beliefs, because being an Old Testament prophet was not an easy thing. Most of them didn't want the job. You see, Jeremiah was the weeping prophet. Moses didn't really want to go through this. But at the same time, they knew God had to make sure. And one thing I've learned over the years, a prophet of God had to be 100% accurate. If they were wrong even once, they were stoned to death. When you would see a prophet speak, they would usually say something like, "Thus saith the Lord," or "Thus saith the Lord God Almighty," and then tell the people to repent, to don't go this way, or you're doing something wrong. And you see that throughout the whole Old Testament, why God's people were always backsliding, because they were going to idolatry or witchcraft. And the other part too is psychics would always have usually a sign that would say, "For entertainment purposes only." And what that was is that it was that statement that you agree that in case if they were not right, well, and then the predictions didn't come true, so therefore you cannot do get angry, because it was only an entertainment. It's like going to a movie and paying for a full price, and then when you go see the movie, it was horrible, so you can't get your money back. So that was the same thing like psychics. But the prophets, God's people, would never do this for money. And like I said, if they were wrong on one, they were stoned. And so to really test all the spirits and knowing God's people, they had to really, really make sure that the prophets of God were in right standing with them to go out. Now, how I got into this was back in 2000. I got a psychic reading done, and his name was Yogi. I don't believe that was his real name, but anyway, in Toronto. And he was pretty accurate. Like a lot of stuff came, other than two things that was supposed to happen never did. But otherwise, he was pretty accurate. And he told me I had the psychic ability, and I would be reading people's futures, and I didn't believe him. And then shortly afterwards, I started making predictions that would come true, or making suggestions, or something would I would say something and it would come true. And I thought maybe there's something about it. And then eventually, one of my good friends at the time, she gave me a set of tarot cards with a book to have a good generalization of what the tarot cards mean and how to understand reading people. So I started doing it for a little bit of fun, just to get the knowledge and all that. And then eventually in 2001 and two, I started doing it around making money. And then 2003, I started working at a tea room, a psychic tea room, with many other psychics, and really just to get involved and indulged in it. It's almost like a learning process, and it's like to get yourself better trained. It's like when you start a job, you do the small things before you get to the bigger parts, right? So, and eventually, I think what most people liked me was I always tried to be more honest. I've tried to be more straightforward. I didn't want to be one of those psychics that say, "Oh, you're gonna win the lottery and you're gonna have a perfect, easy life." I wanted to say, "This is what's happening in your life, and or this is not good what you're doing." And I think that's why I had a lot of accuracy. I've had a lot of success, but I also know why I had those things and what God says. And so without further ado, I'm going to show you some of the stuff and the props that the psychics use, especially the deck of cards, the tarot cards, and channeling and necromancy in astrology. So this is going to be part one, exposing the deck of cards. Now, we've seen all these cards. Some of us have this at our homes. Some of them, we use it to play games and all this, but for a psychic, this was their part of the thing to really start growing. It was our deck of cards. And apparently, the first deck of cards was made for King Charles of France around 1392, or 1390 in the 90s there. And it's actually interesting. King Charles of France was a madman, or he was an insane man. And there's a concept that we use. If we say this person is not playing with a full deck of cards, that's where it comes from King Charles being insane. He's not playing with a full deck. So that's an interesting concept. And you've noticed that you got King, Queen, Jack. King Charles believed in the polytheistic gods. He believed in different gods. And mainly from Babylon, you got your Nimrod, Semiramis, the Queen of Heaven, and their offspring Tammuz. And it goes even like in Egypt, they have like Isis, all the other deities. But no matter where it is or different names, it's still the same person or same people and same practice. And Isis, Diana and Venus, or Dionysus, Horus and Cupid, or Osiris, Zeus and Jupiter. So no matter how you look at it, he believed that he could use ways to foretell futures and named it after his gods or goddesses. And then if you see the number 10, that's supposed to be representative of the law and order, which is what they would think. And it could also represent, too, lawlessness, which is against the Ten Commandments, right? So we have nine. The nines would represent your work or your career or jobs, right? I'm just learning from what psychics have told me and taught me over the years. And then if we have eight, we have one of the most occultic symbols, infinity, and it means wealth, success, happiness. And eight has always been the number of
Well, every number in every culture in numerology always loved the number 8. 7 means perfection. Perfect. You're perfect. Very few people would be the number 7. If they are, that means that they're perfect, they're flawless. Which is interesting because only God of the Bible is perfect. Nobody else. 6 meant failure, flaws, imperfections. The exact opposite of 7. And it's almost a mockery when man had fall, because God made man on the 6th day, and on the 7th he rested. Right? And then 5, you're going with the majority of people. Because the majority of people believe in something, you just accept that you are a follower. And there's nothing wrong being a follower to some extent, but you can't make up your own mind. You have to say, if this person likes this thing, so therefore I like it. Now, number 4, for me, this means structure, but it also meant changes. And think about it, you have seasons. We have, 4 seasons, right? You have wheels, a vehicle has 4 wheels, right? You have legs, table has 4 legs. That's what I always meant there. 3 is feelings or emotions. That's just to say, it's going with how you feel. Not necessarily going the right way, but if it makes you happy, it's okay. 2 is really pretty much structure or relationships. Old things are past, but new beginnings. That's almost like what people in Christ, we are a new creature and old things have passed. And deesis mean this. Alpha, Omega. Beginning, the end. First and last. Death, alive. That's almost a complete mockery of God, of Jesus Christ. Because only He has those titles. And it's very interesting how many people in card games would always say there's always a hidden message through them. And that's why when you notice some people in the occult practices, when you give a gift, you bless it with demons. It's the same thing when you get tarot cards or deck of cards or tarot cards, you bless it with demons. Right? Instead of saying, here's a gift and I bless you with it, like a good Christian, in the occult practice, it's the exact opposite. So, and one thing I've also learned, when I used to play some card games like Euchre and all that, many people have cheated by using secret symbols. If I was to play a game and I want somebody to say spade, I would not say it. I would just go like that. That meant spade. If I wanted club, I would just go like that. Club. If I want a diamond, I would just go like that, because diamond ring. Not everybody would have a ring, but that would be the symbol for diamonds. If I wanted hearts, I would just go like that. So even though they say it's innocent, it's not always an innocent game. So, that's it for the deck of cards. And the next part, I'm going to show you how these deck of cards evolved into known as the tarot cards. Okay, now we're on to the next set, part 2, the tarot cards. And a lot of these tarot cards are the ancestors of the regular deck of cards. And most of them have the same meaning, other than the few extra ones, which is called like more the major Akronos cards, and which is ones we're going to be focusing on and giving some biblical references to it. So it'll be mainly around the Tower of Babel and all that, or other parts there. So, and from Kathy Burns' book, and if you want, you can go there to page 79. The tarot began to take an occult associations used primarily for cartomancy and divination of fortune telling with cards. And the person primarily responsible for these developments of the tarot was a French Huguenot pastor, Antoine Court, the Gobelin, between 1719 and 1784. And sometime in the 1970s, he became an active at Parisian Freemasonry circles that joined the Capulets, the French Masonic occult order, derived from the teachings of the Maritains de Pasquilla in 1774. He became an accomplished occult scholar. The French occult perspective came to be the essential block of revolutionary thought that would bring down the French government in a few years. So that's where it really comes from, the tarot cards, where it began. And it's very interesting, the second person to really accomplish and master the tarot cards is one of Aleister Crowley. If you study anything about the occult, secret societies, if you do not come across Aleister Crowley, you did not do your research. He was one of the most wickedest and evilest men. He was even more evil than Adolf Hitler. And anyway, in her book, The Masonic Occult Symbols, in the book there she says the second accomplished student of the tarot was Aleister Crowley between 1875 and 1947, the order's nemesis in 1909. Crowley began publishing order secrets, including the teaching on the tarot, through the independent journal, The Equinox. Crowley worked with the Freda Harris in design of the new tarot deck, to which composed a commentary much like the Waite's Book of Thoth. It was published in a limited edition in 1944, but the cards were not published until about 1960. Only after a new edition of the Book of Thoth appeared in 1969 did Crowley deck begin to grow in popularity to rival with White's deck of cards, choosing the name deck after the Egyptian deity Thoth. Crowley asserted both his own preference for the Egyptian magical symbolism and his belief in the Gobelin's claims as the deck's Egyptian origin. So, and we have her, a deck of cards is based on the tarot deck of cards based on a system of occult symbols arranged in pattern of 78 cards. 22 are the tarot's major arcana, and then the 56 are suit cards. The minor arcana, arcana. And these cards can be used of divination, and the term tarot is also applied to designate such as divination. So we further informed by an occult organization that tarot has been interpreted as fortune-telling device. But as Gareth Knight reveals, it is profound and powerful system of high resistance magic. So we know this is coming from magic and sorcery and witchcraft. And it's very interesting how they've had some things that come from Egypt. And it's interesting how God told Moses to go to Egypt and bring his children out of Egypt. So, without further ado, I'm going to show you some terms. Some of the cards. I'm not going to go to every single one because there's just too much to go to. But I'm going to show you the ones that are very important. If you look at the deaf card, and for, are you deaf? Or? That's supposed to be a spiritual rejuvenation. Or it's supposed to be like all things are past and you're a new creature, a new belief, a new person. And then it's very interesting. If we go to the Word of God, John chapter 3, verse 35, but it's John chapter 3, verse 35. It says, "The Father loveth the Son, and hath given him all things into his hand." Let's go to Galatians 6, 15. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision available anything, nor circumcision, but a new creature. Interesting, new creature. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. So, it's only through Jesus Christ that gives us all things are passed and become new. Not through a tarot card. It's only that God gives us a new life, a new spirit, a new nation. Not through a tarot card. Let's go to the hanged man, which would be this one right here. And it's very interesting how he's kind of tied to a tree. And it doesn't it say it cursed everyone who hangs on the tree? Let's go to Deuteronomy 21, verse 23. And actually, Deuteronomy is known as the obedience book. To really understand what God expects of his people, it's the obedience. That's why you see a lot of blessings and cursings. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 23. His body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt anywise bury him that day, for his hand is accursed of God, that thy land not be defiled, which the Lord God, thy God, given thee for an inheritance. And Galatians chapter 3. Picking up in verse 13 and 14. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree. So, isn't that interesting? All it is just a pure mockery. If we go towards the Temperance card, and I don't think it's right here. Apparently, the Temperance card means mediation or mediator. Now, very, very interesting. You find a mediator in the book of Timothy. We're going to go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. We're going to pick it up in verses 1 to 5. And I exhort therefore that first of all supplications and prayers, intercessions and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all goodliness and honesty. For this is a good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. notice, it's Jesus that's a mediator, not this tarot card of temperance. Let's go to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 9. And we're going to pick it up, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. And for this cause he is the mediator, Jesus Christ, of the New Testament, that by means of the death for redemption and transgressions that were under the first testament, that they which are called might receive the promise of an eternal inheritance. So it's Jesus Christ that gives us the mediator. He's our mediator, not through this. Let's go to the devil. Now, from my understanding, the devil, when you do a psychic reading, and if somebody gets this, this is supposed to be you're tied up, or you're submitted to him and his ways. And sometimes he also gives you the things of the world, especially the things that you enjoy with your eyes or your flesh. Right? So, let's go to 1 John. And we're going to pick it up in chapter 2 about enjoying some of the things of the world. And see what God says about it. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, and is not of the Father, but is of the world. Interesting. See, because God wants his children to be very, live a holy life. We're supposed to be different. We're supposed to be peculiar. We're supposed to be separate from the world. We live in the world, but we're not of the world. We're supposed to be completely different. And I want to just see something. If one verse. Revelation 13, verse 4. And we're going to go all the way down to verse 4 until 18. And also, this is part of when it says to, when you read it, it's like kind of submitting to him and all that. And I'm going to show you something in Revelation, chapter 13, verses 4 to 18. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, until they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things, and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth to blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle, and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints, and to overcome them. And by the power was given him over all kindreds, and tongues, and nations. And that dwell upon the earth shall not worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He killeth with the sword, he must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. And I beheld another beast coming up unto the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb. He spake as a dragon. He exercises all power of the first beast before him, and he causes the earth, them that dwell in therein, to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that on earth, so that he can make a fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men, and deceive them that dwell all the earth by any means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them, dwell on the earth, that they should make image to the beast which had the wound by the sword and did live. He had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that he had the mark or the name of the beast, and or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that have understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. So it's almost like you're going to worship him in that way, because Satan wants to be worshipped. Also, let's go to 2 Corinthians 11:4. Okay, and 11:4. For if he that have come and preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or you receive another spirit, which ye have not received, or another gospel, you might not accept it, you might. Okay, now I want to show you something in 2 Corinthians 11, chapter 11, verse 13. And it says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transferred into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing that his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. And I will say this. I say again, let no man think me of a fool otherwise, yet a fool receive me that I may boast of myself a little. So Satan himself is going to do everything to deceive the people of the world. It actually even says that in Revelation 18. To the book of Revelation, chapter 18, verse 23, and the light of the candle shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom and the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee, for thy merchants were given the great man of the earth, for by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. So Satan is going to deceive people by witchcraft there. That's why I sent him earlier today and test all the spirits to see the ear of God in 1 John 4. Because most of it is not of God. Now, in the next part of the cards, we are going to do a tower that's hit by destruction. And what it means is that everything's going in chaos, you know, people are in torment, they don't know what to do, they're almost going to a new, other parts of the world to almost get a new understanding, and it's very interesting in the Bible, and if you go to the very, very first book, which is Genesis, it talks about a tower being destroyed, Tower of Babylon. And let's go to that, to Genesis chapter 11. Chapter 11, verses 2. All the way up to 10. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east, and that they found a plain land of Shinar, and that they dwelt there, and that they, and they said one to another, "Go and let us make brick and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and slime as they gone to the mortar. And they said, "Go to and let us build a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, they have all one language. They begin to do, and now nothing will be reinstated from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence and the face of all the earth, and they left off to the building of the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord didn't there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them and abroad upon the face of all the earth. These are the generations of Shem, and Shem was 100 years old, and you get Arphaxad, and 2 years after that, and then it goes on. So, you see, God did not like the Tower of Babel. He hated it, and especially in Babylon. And I find it interesting where Babylon is in the beginning, Babylon's also at the end of Revelation. So, the next part I'm going to show you is probably like three of them in a row. A little bit different. Very similar. You're going to see the star, the moon, and the sun. And notice that there are people or things looking up or doing things of nature worship of deities. Now, throughout many cultures and many countries, people have worshipped either the sun god, which is pretty much Nimrod, or the moon god or goddess, or stars. And I'm going to show you something in Deuteronomy, in chapter 17. Deuteronomy 17. Okay, here we are. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 1 to 3. "Thou shalt not sacrifice unto the Lord thy God any bullock or sheep wherein is blemish, or any evil favoredness, for that is an abomination unto the Lord thy God. If there be found among you within any gates which the Lord thy God hath given thee, man or woman, to have wrought wickedness in the sight of the Lord thy God in transgressing his covenant, and have gone and served other gods and have worshipped them, either the sun, or the moon, or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded." Notice they are worshipping nature, its form of witchcraft. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 15. "Take ye therefore good heed unto yourself, for ye saw all manner of the stimulant on the day that the Lord has spake unto you in Horeb, out of the midst of the fire, lest you corrupt yourself and make you a graven image stimulated of any figure, the likeness of male or female, the likeness of any beast that is on the earth, and likeness in the wind, and all that, and the likeness of anything that creepeth on the ground, likeness of any fish that is in the waters beneath." So it's making images and false gods through nature. Let's go to Book of Jeremiah, the weeping prophet Jeremiah. Chapter
chapter 8. I believe it is. 8, verse 2. And they shall spread them before the sun and the moon and all the host of heaven, whom they have loved and whom they have served, after whom they have walked and whom they have sought. They have worshipped and shall not be gathered nor buried, and they shall be for dawn upon the earth. Let's go to Jeremiah 22, verse 9. And they shall answer because they have forsaken the covenant of the Lord God, Lord their God, and worshipped other gods and served them. See, they were serving other gods other than the one true God. Set of card we're going to look into is the judgment card, and it's very interesting where there's a trumpet with the people from the coffins are about to rise up. Now let's take a chance, or let's look at a verse in Thessalonians. Chapter 4, and we're going to pick it up in verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord, or ever comfort one another with these words. Isn't that interesting? Where it says the trump, the dead in Christ shall rise first, meet them up in the air. Very, very interesting. But we can also take a look at Revelation chapter 1 on this as well. Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Let's go to Revelation 14, verse 7. Sing with a loud voice, fear God, and give him glory. For the hour of judgment is come, and worship him that hath made the heaven and earth, and the sea and the fountains of the earth. Matthew 24, verse 31. And he shall send his angels, and he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together before his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So it's interesting how you got one tarot card
that is almost really trying to tell you everything about the Bible. And all of this is pretty much a pure mockery. The next one we're going to look into is the world. And to live for the things of the world and enjoy the pleasures of it. And really looked into 1 John 2, which is do not love the things of the world. But let's go to the book of Romans. And we're going to pick it up in chapter 12, in verse 2. And maybe see if we should be conformed to the world or not. Romans. Chapter 12, verse 2. And be not conformed to this world, but ye be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and that an acceptable and perfect the will of God. It didn't say to enjoy the things of the world or live worldly. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. We're going to set your affection on the things above, not on the things on earth. Here, with this card, it's saying that we can enjoy the things of the world and all the things of it. Here, in Colossians, in God's Word, it says, set your things above, in heaven, not on things on earth. Because the things on earth are going to be passed on. It's only going to be temporary. Let's go to Titus, chapter 2, verse 12. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. Notice the words, soberly, righteously, godly. That's how we're supposed to live, not lustful things or other ways of the world. Let's go to 1 Corinthians, and we're going to pick it up in chapter 3. Verse 18. Let no man deceive himself, for any man among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool, that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, taketh the wise of their own craftiness, and then again the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, and that they are vain. See, anything worldly is nothing good. Even though God created all things, unfortunately man has just destroyed the concept of using things their own way. So, going to go to the next set of cards, or the next set, or the next card to look at, is Wheel of Fortune, which would be this one right here. And it's interesting, the word fortune comes from a goddess named Fortuna, or that's where you get the word fortunate or unfortunate. Or fortunes. That's where you also get fortune teller from her. And it's also to say to enjoy the things of wealth, money, success. Well, does it say about serving money and loving money? Let's go to Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. See what Jesus says about after money and serving it. No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold on to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, or money. Interesting. Jesus said that you cannot serve both. You have to serve one or the other. Now, there's times where, yes, you need money to pay your needs. I'm not even against God blessing somebody with a little bit of financial gains. But there comes a point when you're tied up in all your mind and spirit is only about money, 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 and you're doing everything else and you're forgetting God. That's when you're serving mammon. There's nothing wrong with being blessed by God, but there comes a point where you're supposed to be setting things above, not on things on earth. I want to go to Timothy. There. First Timothy. 6. Let's see. First Timothy 6. Verse 10. Actually, I'm going to start at verse 9. But then they will be which fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men into destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which, while some coveted, after they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through many sorrows. Wow. Notice. They pierced themselves with many sorrows. And I've seen many people go through so much just to get that extra dollar and all that. Now, I'm not against people working and getting your needs and all that. But there comes a point when if money is all your sole purpose in life and nothing else, then it's a false god. So, anyway, I could go so much more, and every card has its own meaning. But for now, I have other things I need to get accomplished too, so I'm going to start with the next part 3, is astrology, and how astrology is supposed to determine your lives and everything else in the heavenly realms, and but we're going to see what God says about astrology as well. So tune in for part 3. The next list on part 3 is now astrology, and we're going to see how well it works or doesn't work and what the Bible really says. And I want to show you something in Isaiah chapter 47. And we're going to pick it up in verse 13. Okay, here we are. Thou art wearied in the multitude of the counsels. Let now the astrologers, stargazers, and the monthly procrastinators stand up and save thee from these things that shall come upon thee. Behold, they shall be as the stubble, the fire shall burn them. They shall not deliver themselves from the power of the flame. There shall be not a coal to warm at all, nor the fire to set before it. This thou shall be unto thee with whom thou hast labored, even their merchants from thy youth, they shall wander everyone to his quarter, none shall save thee. That's not a good thing here. Especially with astrology, it's not really good. Now, we're going to say, what is astrology? Astrology is the ancient art or science of divining the fate of future of human beings from indications given the positions of the stars and other heavenly bodies. The Encyclopedia Britannica, volume 2, page 575 from 1956. It is assumed that our lives are largely influenced through, not completely determined, by the position and movement of the heavenly bodies. And it's the same thing with horoscopes, zodiacs, and all that stuff. It's the same thing, it's just differently. And what I find interesting is that sometimes you don't even know if you go based on the charts of the house, because if you go with that, you're supposed to start with Aries all the way up to Pisces. But if you are a certain month, then you go from one part and then all the way to the other side. It's never consistent. And even if, say, two people are born in the same, say, country, the same province, the same city, in the same hospital, even in the same room, at the same exact time, it still comes to a different conclusion how someone still lives and the other person doesn't. So it's never really stable, because how can you get two people born at the same time, same place, same location, and everything else exactly the same and still come to a different lifestyle? It's not really good. So here's why astrology is supposed to offer an explanation for life. People wonder why things happen the way they do, and it is the meaning of life. Astrology claims to explain determined forces behind what's happening. People are often bored with life, and their jobs and lives are a routine. Anything different or unique fascinates them. They may think they're gaining insight and information others don't have, or becoming part of those in the know. In the short, people pursue astrology or divination for many same reasons see cult and other aspects of the occult. The scientific basis for astrology, despite the fact that astrology began in pagan, superstition efforts have been found a scientific basis for it. However, there is no evidence that heavenly bodies can influence your character. If you're a living intelligent being, your character is formed by the living intelligent beings, inheritance from your ancestors, and influence of your families and friends, and especially your own choices and decisions. The sun, the moon, and planets are lifeless and unintelligent. How can they form your character? There's no proof that the position of these bodies at the time of your birth can influence your life right now. Heavenly bodies do have some physical influence. The sun gives energy, the bodies give light, the moon's gravity causes tides, but all these influences affect everyone in an era equally, regardless what time you were born. In the calendar, the astrology uses determination the sign of your birth does not agree with the present position in your constellations. In the technical sense, if the world 12 signs of the zodiac or geometrical divisions, 30 degrees in extent, counting from the position of the sun, in the position of the sun at the vernal equinox, and the time of the Hipparchus 2,000 years ago, when the signs of the zodiac were defined, the signs corresponded fairly closely with the constellations, and that this say the first sign, called Aries, corresponded with the constellation of Aries. Owing to precession wobbling of the Earth's axis, there is now disparity amounting to the breadth of a whole sign that the sign Aries is occupied by the constellation Pisces. And that's in the Encyclopedia Britannica, volume 23, verse page 959. So, let's go to Daniel. The book of Daniel. Let's go to Daniel chapter 4. And we're picking up in verse 7. Then came the magicians, the astrologers, and the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers, and I told them the dream before them. They did not make known unto the interpretation. Interesting. And let's go to Daniel chapter 5. Verse 7.
The king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the chaldeans, and the soothsayers, and the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, "Whoso shall read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about his neck, and shall be the third ruler of the kingdom." But then came in the king's wise men that could not read the writing nor make known to the king interpretation. So you see, in the book of Daniel, the astrologers cannot understand Nebuchadnezzar's dream. They did not know it. And for people that's supposed to have powers who know all these things and the knowledge, they did not know that. So remember earlier when I was showing you the deck of cards with the sun, the moon, and stars? This astrology is a form of idolatry. And it's something God does not like. And when you do idolatry, it really makes God angry. Let's go to Amos. 525. Okay. It's going to say everything that comes from astrology, and even the deck of cards, tarot cards, and all this psychic definition is a form of idolatry. Now, idolatry is not necessarily a performance, a ritual you do physically, although that is true. It's also in your spirit, what you're putting all your time, energy, and focus on, and seeing if something will come if you do certain things, all these things. And especially when you come to channeling, necromancy as well, that's really where your form of idolatry is, and it's also comes that, and with astrology, it's not to be taught, because if you go to the book of Proverbs 27, verse 1, boast not self of tomorrow, for knows not what day may bring forth. It's interesting. Nobody doesn't know what tomorrow will bring forth. Let's go to what James 4:14 says. What shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor, and that appearing for a little time, and that vanishes away. So even the book of James says the same thing. It says, no man knows what will happen tomorrow. And the next part of this would be going into channeling and necromancy, communicating with familiar spirits, and I was going to see what God says about that. So, stay tuned.
The next part of the Bible I want to show you is in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, and we're going to pick it up in verse 9. And we're going to pretty much read all the way up to 12. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations to those nations. I'm going to say this. Notice, shall not learn to do after these abominations. The word abomination here pretty means hate. And that's like something that is the closest word to God, hating something so much. And so this, pay attention now with what's going to happen here. There should not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through fire, or that uses divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. Necromancer, communicating with familiar spirits, communicating with the dead. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord thy God, or the Lord God, or to the Lord. And because these abominations, the Lord thy God doth draw them out of before thee. Again, saying any of these is an abomination. And I would say when God says something like this, it's better to listen and do this. Now, during my times, I was reading people with tarot cards and all that. It wasn't often, but I had times where I communicated with familiar spirits or people that were deceased. And it was not really my forte, but I had done it. And whether people say they're good or accurate, the thing is, whether or not they're good or not, God said not to do them. It's an abomination. And at that time, I didn't know who God was at the time, because if I knew God and I was practicing that, that would not have been good. But because I didn't know God at that time, and I was doing those things, he had to show me why it was really wrong. And most of these things is that these familiar spirits are familiar with your lifestyle. They know you're familiar with your family, your friends, your coworkers, your jobs, your careers. So they're not actually really, really those people. They're just humans disguised or masquerading that type of person. The only one that really, anywhere in the Bible that really had a real someone encounter is in Samuel, where Saul goes to Ednor and she communicates to find Samuel or communicate with Samuel. And it happens, and then God was not happy with Saul, and then Saul died in his sin of that. Let's go to 1 Chronicles. We're going to pick it up. I think it's in chapter 10. Is it? Chapter 10. Yeah. 1 Chronicles chapter 10, verse 13. So Saul died for his transgression which he committed against the Lord, even against the word of the Lord which he kept not, and also asking counsel of one that had familiar spirit to inquire of it. And he inquired not of the Lord, and therefore he slew him, and turned him the kingdom unto David the son of Jesse. So notice, Saul died in sin, because in the first Samuel 28, he was communicating with a medium who wanted to contact the prophet Samuel. And whether that was a good thing or not, or real or not, God was not happy. And you see that? He died in his sin. So, not a good thing. And one last thing that I've learned, there was a woman that I used to work with for many, many years. She used to do a lot of channeling, necromancy, mediumship, but she was also into voodoo, shamanism from Africa. And she was born in England, but she lived in Africa for many, many years and her family there and before she came to Toronto. And she told me a lot of things. And there was always in the statement of a prayers that she would do in her occultic practice. And there was a term you would find called as above, so below. And I'm going to show you what that means in the next part.
The next part I want to say is that there was the one lady, Eva, who for, I believe she was six generations into the occult voodoo shamanism, witchcraft lifestyle. And one thing when she used to pray in the ending of her prayers would be as above, so below. And normally, in occult practices, in pagans, they would always use a crystal. Normally, this is not a clear one, but usually it would be clear, it would be pointing, and they would be praying. Notice with the tarot cards earlier, with the magician or sorcerer or the devil, they're doing the as above, so below concept. So they would be doing all this. Sometimes they would more do it where there's more nature, and then they can have the surrounding areas. They'll make a little small fire with candles or near the water or river, and they'll have the air and sitting on the or standing on the ground, which is your earth, which is your four elements. And then they would be praying and something in the concepts of let all the goddesses and gods of the earth, fire, wind, to give me the strength and the new me of let your ways be done, and then as above, so below, give me the strength and power. It would be on something those lines of those prayers, and that has always been an occultic symbol for many, many years, and God wants nothing to do with that. He doesn't want his people to do it. And I find it interesting, in his version of the Bible, I can't even call it version of the Bible, but Eugene H. Peterson uses that same term in his version of the Lord's Prayer. And let's see. Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world right. Do what's best, as above, so below. Keep us alive with 3 square mirrors. Keep us forgiven with you and forgiving others. Keep us safe from ourselves and of the devil. You're in charge. You can do anything you want. You're a blazing beauty. Yes, yes, yes. And actually, my friend, Brother Tom, showed me something with this word, yes, yes, yes. If you were to somehow find the numbers of it, and like say A is 1, 2, B is 2. Apparently if you do numerology and all that, that comes up to 666. So, now, I want to show you what the Lord's Prayer says in this Bible. Here we are. After this manner, therefore, pray, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power of the glory forever. Amen. So, you think that's really, these two things are telling you the same thing? No. Because, why would God use something that's an occultic term when he doesn't like occultic terms, or rituals, or performances? Because he never wants anything to do with it. He never wanted his people to learn occult practices or teachings or traditions. He said to follow him, his voice, his word. So. And, I'm just gonna see this. The as above, so below is an occult maxim. The word occult means hidden, and the word maxim means truth. Underlying principle. When witches seal a circle, casting a space or a spell, they often use the words as above, so below in their circle or spell is sealed. So mote it be, that's great. But what does this mean? The word as above, so below stem from the mystery traditions, alchemy, and specifically from the amazing piecework called the Emerald Tablet. So, anyway, it all comes from Satan himself. If any of you have been going to psychics or doing any things or enchanters or spellcasters or anything like that, you need to repent. You need to go to Christ and ask him to forgive you and turn away from these things, because this is not pleasing to God. And I want to do, in the next part, I'm going to give you all the list of verses of Bible scriptures. Ready? And now we're coming to the conclusion to this, posting all the psychic stuff that I, and what the Word of God says about it. And I just wanted to bring up to you some scriptures to really indicate that God does not want anybody practicing and doing this. But I want to bring this. In Toronto, in every part of every city, no matter where you're living, you'll come across a newspaper. This was a small free newspaper. Some people, you pay a little bit more for bigger ones and all that. But it doesn't matter if it's a free one or if you pay for it or the size of it. They always seem to have astrology or horoscopes. And you notice they're trying to give advice. So whether or not, it's always in the newspapers every single day. And also, you'll have a little directory and it'll tell you all these astrologers or psychics or healers or curse removers or witch doctors. And it's interesting how some of these people, like there is one who says he's 100% guaranteed. Now, not that I have anything against this person personally, but no psychic was ever 100%. I've never met one psychic who was ever 100% or an astrologer that was 100%. The only one that's 100% is true is God. God is true. It doesn't matter if he was the Holy Spirit or Jesus Christ. God is the only one that's 100% and God is the only one that's true. Every man a liar and God be true, according to Romans 3. And notice that how he is, ready. Notice how they're saying, like, they're the number one. And apparently they have all power to do this and all that. 100%, again, lifelong protection to all kinds of problems. And I'm going to show you a verse in the Bible and let's see if they have any power on earth to do what they claim to do. Let's go to Matthew. And let's go to Matthew 28. And we're going to pick it up in verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Notice, it didn't say, well, this person has some power if you want to go after this person, or this astrologer has it, or this deity has some
Jesus Christ has all power. After his death and resurrection, he has all power. It did not say he had 50% or he has power for some time and then it changed into another deity or to another person. No. Jesus Christ currently, from 2,000 years ago to now, has all power on heaven and in earth. Praise God. God bless him, I mean, for what he has done. Let's go to Peter. The book of Peter. In 1 Peter, and we're going to go to chapter 5, verse 6 and verse 7, it says, "Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for your soul." Notice, we go to him for everything. We're not supposed to be going to these people. God is the only one we're supposed to be going to. That threw these people into witchcraft. We need only the grace of love of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. So, and I just want to show you some things about witchcraft and all these things about what God says and really going into the scriptures. So please bear with me. The first part we're going to is 1 Samuel 15. In verse 23, and it says, "For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and the stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath also rejected thee from being king." Let's go to 2 Kings 9:22. And it came to pass when Joram saw Jehu, and it said, "Is it peace, Jehu?" And he answered, "What peace, so long as the whoredoms of thy mother Jezebel and her witchcrafts are so many." Not good. Let's go to 2 Kings 17. Let's go to pick it up through 16. And here's what it says. "And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God and made them molten images, even the two calves, and made a grove, and worshipped all the host of heaven, and served Baal. And they caused their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire," which is actually child abortion, or child sacrifice, "and used divination and enchantments, and sold themselves to do evil in the sight of the Lord, to provoke him to anger. Therefore, the Lord was very, very angry with Israel."
This is actually Israel's God's people. His own people. This isn't even just pagans. This is God's people. The Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them out of his sight. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. And Judah kept not the commandments of the Lord their God, but walked in the statutes of Israel, which they made. Noticing that definition witchcraft is not a good thing. Let's go to 2 Chronicles 33, verse 6. And he caused his children to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Also he observed times, and used enchantments, and used witchcraft, and dealt with the familiar spirit, and with wizards. He sought much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Kind of noticing here a pattern, it's making God angry when you do these things. God doesn't like it. Let's go to Micah, chapter 5, verse 12. And it says, I will cut off witchcrafts out of thine hand, and thou shalt have no more soothsayers. Let's go to Acts chapter 19. Many of them which also used the curious arts brought their books together and burned them before all men. They counted the price of them and found it 50,000 pieces of silver. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. So you know, when you have anything of an occultic books or anything that's like that, you burn them. Anything that was used for that, burn it. Praise God. Let's go to the book of Nahum. Nahum chapter 3. Verse 4. Because of the multitude of the whoredoms and the well-favored harlot and the mistress of the witchcrafts that selleth nations through her whoredoms and the families through her witchcrafts. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 20. Verse 20.
Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, accumulations, wrath, strife, seductions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revealers, and such like, of which I have told you before, which, as I have also told you in the past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Notice it didn't say those things will be okay, or God's okay with it, don't worry, do whatever. No, God hates this, and they will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. And I've heard people say, it's not a big deal, oh, you don't know what they're going through. God's saying these people will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. And it's the word of God, and God is true, and every man a liar. Let's go to Revelation 21. And we're just ready to almost wrap this up. Revelation 21, verse 8. But the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, and the murderers, and the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake of fire, or in the lake which burneth with fire, and the brimstone, which is the second death. Again, God is saying these people are not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. They're going to be thrown into second death in the lake of fire. So, but the reason why, mainly, when you look at everything from the occult practices and why people do this, this is when you go to a psychic, an astrologer, or a spellcaster, or anybody that does witchcraft and all that, it is a form of idolatry. So, as an example, Brother Edwin wants to go to see a psychic. He goes and sees me. I'm his god. Or the cards or the props are his god. And that's taking away from God's glory. That's taking, and God is not a god that shares glory. In Isaiah, he says he does not share his glory with absolutely nobody else. He's the only one. He was the only one that created the heavens and the earth. He's the one that created everybody and everything. And that's why we're supposed to go to him. And throughout the whole Old and New Testament, scriptures are clear that God wants nothing to do with this. God wants none of his children to be doing this. But for some reason, it's some of these things are practiced in the churches today. I remember even when the Lord revealed to me just shortly, just after 2011, around December, one church tried to call me up and tried to say I could be a professional medium and offered me a job doing with their church. And it was this, like, called a spiritual church. And I just said, okay, I was only like a Christian for like not even a full month, for a couple months. And I'm like, God said that they're not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. God wants nothing to do with them. And so I rebuked them and I said, no. And I just think it's Satan comes in so deceiving to deceive all. That's why I said in earlier in 1 John, in chapter 4, to test all the spirits to see if they're of God. Right? Because in these last days, Satan is trying to get his God's people to fall and fall into sin. So, and I just pray for the people who go to see these psychics or astrologers or anybody else. And I say, you don't need to go to them. Just pray to God. Just pray and say, Lord, just I'm going through this. Show me truth. Sometimes the answer is not always what you want to hear, but truth also sets us free. If you're a psychic or you practice some of these things, you need to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You need to repent. You need to get rid of this occult practice. Because God wants nothing to do with this. And he's not going to allow people into heaven if they're practicing this. This is the word. And the word is truth. And I just pray and you humbly seek him. And just accept him, and thank you so much, and God bless you all, and for taking the time to watch this. I hope you were edified, and God bless you in the name of Jesus. Thank you. Please come.